know, I don't think it matters where you come from. I don't think it
Greetings, Commanders! Welcome to Kerrash Landing, the Elite Dangerous Community Show. Commander Kerrash here, and it is good to be back in the pilot seat for you folks tonight. Joining me on the show tonight, we have a good friend and streamer, Bubble. How you doing?
I'm doing good.
Now, you folks might know your streamer is a Bubble Map Gaming Live, isn't it? And you've had lots to do with the Elite community and other games and things like that, haven't you?
Indeed, I have.
I think the last time we spoke, we were just saying about this before we come on air, was the GTA crazy stream that we had, which was great fun. I think we definitely have to do that again sometime.
Yeah.
So greetings to everyone in the chat. Thank you for joining in. It's lovely to see familiar names and faces there. Great to see you all. How was your week away, everyone? I know, 2 weeks. 2 weeks away, I wasn't streaming, but I must say a big, huge, massive thank you to Fiery Toad and Mad Dog for covering me in their streams. I've heard lots of fun things about the streams. Did you catch any of those streams, Bubble?
I did. I caught them both, unfortunately.
Now, there's lots of rumours going around. Everyone was referring to them as the Morecambe and Wise of Elite streamers. Yeah, so I definitely need to catch up on some more clips. I've caught a few bits and pieces. My wife's given me the rundown on some of those things that happened, but it sounded like you had a blast. XLG there, thank goodness you're back. I think Toad would have kept Dog on a short leash, so I'm sure everything was fine, really. Oh dear, so yes, Bubble, my word, E3, you caught a lot of it, didn't you?
I did, yeah.
I certainly didn't. No, it's madness. Like I said, the closer you get to it, you just get blinkered in, you're in this little box for the whole time, and you don't see any of it. So I come back, and all these people were talking about all these things, and I'm like, what, they announced that when we were there? What? You know. But yeah, it was great. It was absolutely awesome, and we will get onto that shortly, because it was amazing fun, and I'm sure everyone wants to know everything about what happened. And of course, I can only tell you about 10%. But that's... My NDA staring at me. It's not fair. But yeah, but we will get onto that shortly. There's some really, really cool stuff in there. And I don't know how to go about this, because I suppose an apology is the wrong word, but I must kind of point out, and I know there was a couple of people that were angry at me because I squeed so loudly last week, which is like, well, I was excited, what can I say? But I think it was a little bit odd, because there was a lot of things that people expected out of E3, and there was a lot of anticipation, and I know everyone was kind of thinking, oh, they're going to show planetary landings. There was lots of people saying, oh, they're going to show planetary landings, or they're going to show Stargoids or something like that. But of course, they didn't. They had other things they wanted to announce on E3. Now, I was genuinely excited for these things. I thought they were going to be great. I thought it was going to be a really good idea, and I think they genuinely are still. I mean, you know, the Xbox One release has been awesome. There's been tens of thousands of new commanders. Everyone say, don't stop squeeing. Yes. Oh, squee! But yeah, I think it just got a little bit blown out of all proportion because people have built up this hype in their mind of what was coming, and everyone was kind of imagining their own story for what was going to be the big announcement at E3, and then when it wasn't what they were expecting, people were getting angry about it, and it's just like, well, that's kind of crazy when you put it that way. But then furthermore to kind of blame me for being excited for the thing that you're not excited about is kind of like, I mean, come on, I can't apologize for that. I'm like, I was excited. I'm like, there we go. Hashtag hype. Yes, PlayPay's got it there now. It's what can I say? You know, I was excited. You know, I mean, to give you a rundown, I mean, I arrived on the Friday night, and I mean, first of all, it was great to be at Frontier. So I was already buzzing. I was like, yay, I'm at Frontier. And then, of course, they showed me the trailer for Planet Coaster, which I thought, excellent. I'm really looking forward to Planet Coaster.
Really looking good.
I know, it's so awesome. Hoping I can stream that. Please, let me stream it, please. Yeah, so I mean, I saw that. They showed me the trailer before anyone else had seen it. It was like, oh, dudes, I'm so happy that you're making another coaster game, because obviously they made the Roller Coaster Tycoon 3, which was awesome, sold 10 million copies, which is great. And then they showed me that, they showed me what was coming up in E3, what they were going to be doing, the Xbox One launch and all that. Then they showed me the trailer for CQC, which no one else had seen at that point, which is like, oh my god, this is really, really cool. And then, of course, they said, hey, do you want to go upstairs and have a go on it? I was like, heck yeah! You damn right! So I went upstairs and I met up with the QA guys, and they were having a... they met with the designers first, and they were having a match against the QA guys. Now, sorry, I kept catching some of the chat in there. Sorry, I don't mean to be ignoring you guys. I'm just waxing lyrical about my trip there. And yeah, that was amazing fun to have a match up with those guys, but we'll talk about that more. So, Bubble, before I go off on a rant, because I apologise for that, I was on a roll. Why don't you tell us a little bit about, I mean, how did you get into doing to streaming and everything?
Well, it's a rather long story, but it's not very interesting. I've been following this streamer. They're quite a big streamer. They pull in about 10,000 views on an average stream. I was just watching them. They go through different games, and one day that I saw them, they were playing this game I'd never heard of before called Elite Dangerous, and I caught like the last 10 minutes of their stream, and them lifting up out of the dock and flying out the front of the mail slot. I was like, this looks awesome. So I went, where can I get this? And you could, I was like, you can get beta access. I was like, I'm in. So I went in, and after a couple of days, this streamer just seemed that I could still see them playing the game, but they weren't streaming it as much. Mm-hmm. I was like, so I went around and searched Elite Dangerous on Twitch, and I came across this streamer. Not many people know about him, called Fiery Toad.
Oh, yeah. Name and I well. Just...
And it was the day before the people who brought the beta could get into it, I think. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. It's a while ago now, and I just sat there all day going, can I play now? Can I play now?
No, I mean, this is what I love about the streaming community stuff. When I first started it off, obviously, it was just me back right at the start. But, you know, just I love the fact that it's exploded and there's so many different channels and so many people doing it and people just showing their love for the game and streaming. I love that. It's absolutely brilliant. I'm always giving shout-outs to everyone. And it's, you know, the guys at Frontier, they cannot say thank you enough. They really do appreciate all the support that the streamers have been giving the game and getting the word out there. So, that I just want to echo that sentiment to you guys, because I know it doesn't always come out, you know, they are quite tight-lipped about what's going on, so it's nice to kind of say that yes, they genuinely are really, really happy with everything everyone's been doing streaming, and they want more of it. Interestingly enough, you may have caught me, I mean, the other thing that happened obviously when I was at Frontier was I managed to stream that night with Ed. We were literally, we had everything was set to go, being interdicted, damn you, I'm going to submit, Yeah, so we were sat there, everything was set to go, we were just waiting for the last few assets to get put onto the memory stick and things like that, and Ed said, hey, do you want to stream? I was like, yeah, hell yeah, you know, absolutely. So we walked over to the other building and got out there and started doing the stream, which was really, really great fun. And Ed was just saying to me that it's something they really want to try and focus on getting more streams done and more video content and stuff for everyone out there. Things like interviews with some more of the dev team and stuff like that. Obviously, they are insanely busy, so they don't really have time to be doing everything they want to do, you know, and kind of getting the content out there that we're all asking for. But they are going to make a concerted effort this year to do more of that for us, which I think is really, really awesome. And big thumbs up to Frontier for saying that. And it's something I really do want to point out, because I know there was a couple of people asking me about, you know, because there was a couple of people that left Frontier, and it was all on amicable terms. I know, and there's a couple of big names that we know of. So people were kind of getting concerned about things. Oh, people are leaving. I can say without a shadow of a doubt, when I went there on that Friday, I have never seen the place busier. And like insanely busy, and they've actually gone and had to get more office space than they initially had. So they are damn busy, and they've got lots of people working there. So do not be concerned about that. More to the point, actually, there is a financial report which we will get on later too as well, which was quite good. I don't know if anyone saw that. Did you see that, Bubble?
I did. Mm. I had a look.
Yeah, really, really promising report that was. And, oh, so excited! So much more to come. Bubble Mac Gaming, are you live yet? Plepe's asking.
I think he's asking if I'm there yet.
Are you there yet? Sorry, yes.
No, I haven't reached such a state yet.
Yeah, we were just talking about this, wasn't it? So you're taking the pilgrimage. You're attempting to do the crazy journey.
I am. I'm only 5,000 light years out now, and it's just getting so close.
Oh, is that tantalizing? Yeah, I know how you feel. It's those last few hundred light years are just kind of like, oh. It's like, oh, you've got to that point where you're just worn out.
Just going to get there. Oh, now I've got to go home.
I did wait around a little bit. I mean, I kind of had a look at a few things around the location. I didn't do too much. I know there was a lot of, you know, I've just realised I'm an idiot. I completely muted the game there. I was waffling for so long. I didn't look around too much, and I'm kind of annoyed with myself now because I missed out on a load of things. I know there's a whole bunch of, like, what are they called? Wolf Rayet stars and things like that nearby. There's a whole bunch of areas like that. I completely missed the damn things, but I know my good friend Abacus, there he is in the chat, he is still out there, and he is scanning somewhere in the region. He's got about 1,000 neutron stars he's trying to get through.
1,000.
It's going to come up with like 1 billion credits in exploration or something like that. But yeah, but best of luck to both of you. I think it's awesome that you're attempting to do that. It is well worth it. It's like off the bucket list, isn't it? It's like, yes, mm-hmm. I did that. I've been there. Oh, there we go. Pop. Did I get any credits for that? No, I didn't get any credits. I should have got merits for that, shouldn't I? He was an enemy. Ah! Damn you all to heck. Never mind. Right. Moving right along. Any questions? Sorry, guys, if I missed questions. Gaming with Ian? Yeah, it's you know, I was referring to a couple of people that we knew about. I mean, Tom Cool, obviously, sadly, left the team earlier in the year. And I can't remember who it was now, but someone did leave to go up to Manchester. It was closer to their family, and like I said, it was all on amicable terms, so there is nothing wrong with Frontier. I mean, whilst we're on the subject, actually, let's bring up the financial report, in case anyone didn't see it. So this went out, so this was the end of May this year. Frontier put out their financial report, and I was really pleased to see this, I must admit, because, see if I can get it up on this, no, I can't get it up on the screen, damn it. Damn it. I was really pleased to see this, because, I mean, it is worrying. It's like, you know, for a lot of us, Frontier is a big black box, and we have no idea what goes on inside it. So you kind of get those concerns. You don't know how well they're doing. You don't know if the game is doing okay, if things are going all right inside the company. So I can understand people's concerns and fears for the thing. But from the financial report, they have exceeded their expectations of what they were going to do. They've actually paid off one of their loans early. They've got net cash balance of 10.5 million pounds now. I was going to say credits then. you know, they've had some huge successes with some of their other games as well. Tales from Deep Space, Planet Coaster's been announced. They've pushed out over 640,000 units of Elite Dangerous. That is insane. That is so cool. And yeah, they're just in a really, really good place financially. So I think, you know, for any of those people that are spreading fear, uncertainty and denial and out there, they're just completely unfounded fear. So don't worry. Another federal agent. All hail the Emperor. So I'm going to start a new game. So everyone who has got a drink, every time I mention a certain Electronics Entertainment Expo by its acronym, be specific, everyone must drink. So go and get your drinks now, because it might get a bit repetitive after a while.
A little bit.
Oh, he hasn't got anything useful. It's just an adder. Leave me alone. They've got nothing useful today. Hey, Chris Viking, like the little icon there. Brilliant. Hail the Emperor, bask in his glory. Yes, Montoxia, I'll start it off. I did mean E3, drink. Yes, oh, it's great fun. So, obviously we've got the newsletter to go over. There's a couple of other points I wanted to raise. So, now, where did they get to that? Yeah, there was, this is a silly little thing. Now, last year at E3, there was something that David told me about, which I thought was deadly secret. And I didn't realize that in 2014, last year, in PC Gamer, he had a review with them, and he actually, interview with them, and he actually did say that they were considering these damn things. And this is one of the things, that was part of what I was saying earlier on about saying things I shouldn't say and all that sort of stuff. I don't know what I can say and what I can't say, so I just kind of keep shtum. I mean, I'm generally really excited, and I want to tell everyone everything I've seen, because it's so awesome. But one of the things he mentioned was about, like, they're planning to look at surface vehicles and things like that. And he actually did say it in the interview, but I was so worried about whether or not it was public that I haven't told anyone for a year. Here we are in this E3. Ah, damn it. Drink. And yeah, I realised that he has actually mentioned they've been considering surface vehicles. So, yes, I can tell everyone they're considering surface vehicles. How cool is that? But yeah, I mean, it is a really tricky thing. So I must admit, if I'm teasing or being secretive or coy, honestly, there is no hard feelings to it whatsoever. It literally is. I can't remember what I can and can't say. There is so many cool things. What I can genuinely say though is, I saw way more than what they presented at E3 this year. Ah, drink again!
Jeez.
I don't often swear, but holy shit, it was awesome what I saw. And I can't even say. Just say, the stuff that's coming up is going to be just glorious. I haven't got enough words to describe it. It's going to be amazing when I can actually talk about the stuff which is upcoming. It just looks incredible. But there we go. Big squee, Montoxia. Yes, squee.
Squee.
Absolutely. Huge, huge squee. So now I've docked. Let's look at getting the newsletter up for you guys. Let's see if we can do this. Last time I attempted to do this, it went horribly wrong. So let's try again. And boom, newsletter. Woohoo! Yes, there is a newsletter. Newsletter 80. Grats. Big 8-0. Shenray saying, no, I'm so excited, I'm about to turn into a bobblehead. Yes, yes, I must say, I don't know whether to say thank you to Toad and Dog for doing that, but temporarily during E3, I turned into a bit of a meme, didn't I? Yes. My bobblehead went viral, yes, yes, yes. You terrorists. But no, it was hilarious. I shared it around with the guys. Frontier and everything, and they just thought it was absolutely hilarious. And yeah, it was all over the forums, and it was all over the Skype chat, and yes, so yes.
I now have my very own Crash bobblehead.
Oh, it's crazy. I couldn't believe it, but it was really, really great fun. It was just something, I mean, I was talking to Dog and Toad before I left, and we were kind of trying to come up with ideas for what could happen on the stream, and I said, look, I'll record a couple of video clips of a few things. And that was just the one that just stuck, I think. So thanks to the guys for making that viral. It was brilliant. It says E3 on the screen. Ah, Montaxia, you curse you. Did the stream freeze there? What's going on? Is the stream okay? Yep, looks okay. It's weird. I'm getting some lag on there. Twitch getting twitchy here. Everyone's saying.
It seems to be.
Maybe it's. I think we're back now. Yep, seems to be back now. Oops, sorry for that. Yeah, there was a little bit of a little bit of a glitch with Twitch.
Yeah, it seems to be good now.
Twitch doing some funny things. A bit gone laggy. Yeah. Keep an eye on it. Let me just have a quick look. No, it's not. Yeah, I can see it's going up and down. No, we haven't got any problems here. They're very, very weird. Well, apologies for this, folks.
Apparently the audio is fine.
Oh, so everyone's getting my audio okay, but the video is... that is very, very odd. PC's responding okay. I mean, I've got no major problems with this. Okay, let's try turning it off and on again, maybe? We like that. Boom, boom, boom. Technical issues. It wouldn't be a stream without technical issues.
No. Something had to go wrong.
Hashtag refund. Hashtag refund. Yeah, I was going to say, yeah, everything was prepared. Everything was ready to go. It was all cushy. And then everything just started going wrong right towards the end. I think that might have sorted it. I just turn it all off and on again. I'm going to bring it back up now. So I think I'm okay. You had arms like noodles, and you had zero drops from OBS, so it's probably Twitch. Yeah, Twitch is, yeah, not always great. We all know that. We're all used to that by now. Yay! It looks like it's okay now. Let's try and get the game started back up then. Okay, so close everything down. Try again. Close the web browser. Close this. Close that. Let's bring it back up. Prince Fox. Yeah, put the bobblehead on whilst you wait. I need that as a holding screen. I think definitely I have it. So it's right, there we go. Let's. Everyone likes the spinning ship of death. Oh. I think we might have lost it again. It's a crash loading screen from Shen right there. Nope, I think the video's locked again. What is going on with this? Freeze. How's that? I think we're back in the room. I think it was actually the web browser. Trying to get the web browser window was causing a problem there. Bring, game was Ian, yep, I think you hit the nail on the head there. It was just got to that point. I think it was the newsletter which was killing it. So we will go back to old school and read through the newsletter, I think. crash in the pink. yeah, that was my pink screen of death. There we go. Yes. Cool. Right, so let's get on. So yes, obviously the big announcement, Frontier were at a certain... gaming expo last week. I won't say it. Yeah, but no, that was really, really good. I mean, we got out there early on the Saturday evening. We got everything set up, ready to go. We were all good, thought everything was fine, and then suddenly all the Xboxes stopped working. Panic on, oh God, what have we done? What's going on? And then, of course, someone comes upstairs and say, yeah, Microsoft just made some announcement and Xbox Live has just gone kaput. It's like, oh, right, okay, so it wasn't us. That was the main thing. We were ready to go, even if Microsoft weren't. But yeah, no, so that was a bit of a whew, panic moment, but then everything was fine, back to normal. And yeah, but no, it was great. We were all set up ready Sunday, and then of course Monday early they made the announcements of Elite Dangerous coming to Xbox One, which I can finally talk about.
Hey.
Woo! And I can admit now, yes, I bought one of these controllers and I'm practicing for a couple of days. And yes, of course I've got it on Xbox One because it's great. It is great. I mean, it is awesome to have it in the front room though. I mean, Bob, have you had a chance to play it on the Xbox at all? Have you seen it?
I've seen it, but I haven't had a chance to play it on the Xbox.
It's really good. I mean, I say surprise is probably the wrong word, but I am kind of like really impressed that the guys have managed to get the entire PC game, like everything, all in that little tiny machine. You know what I mean? It's damn impressive. I mean, the word we were using to the journalists was uncompromised, and it truly is. There is nothing cut out. Because everyone was asking that question. It's like, well, what did you have to remove to get it on the Xbox One? And it was like, nothing. Really nothing. Everything's in there, even all the PowerPlay stuff. Everything that you've got in the PC version is available on the Xbox version, which is insane. And that's a huge achievement. So massive kudos to the guys at Frontier for doing that.
Yeah,
It's.
compared to the technology you can have with a PC, it's just pretty amazing to get it working so
Yeah.
well on an Xbox.
Absolutely. And the best thing is, one of the things that I really want to point out, because there wasn't enough emphasis on this actually, because people were saying about, oh, you're spreading your resources on Xbox One, it's, you know, you're not concentrating on the PC anymore, blah blah blah. You know, there was a lot of people that were complaining about that kind of thing as well. But I will say, without a shadow of a doubt, that bringing it on Xbox One is going to be fantastic for the PCs as well, because they have done a whole host of optimizations to squeeze it onto that machine, and all of those things are going to come back in engine for PC players. So everyone running smaller graphics cards and stuff on PC, and even people running the bigger graphics cards, are going to see a frame rate boost as soon as those optimizations are fed back into the PC version. So, you know, rise on. It's excellent. But that's, yeah, gaming with Ian, you've hit the nail on the head there, really. The PC hardware is very similar to the Xbox One. Same with the PlayStation 4 as well. They are basically small PCs. That's what they are. So they will be very, very similar to do it. All questions on XLG 47. What about the PS4 version? Can I say no comment? I mean, I think, I'm pretty sure it's been publicly said that they would like to see it on other platforms in the future. I think that's all I can say. It's like, I hate it. I got this big list of things do and don't. Checking more questions. Any more questions that I can answer? Grim Hippie, yes, it is tried and tested on PCs and consoles. So yeah, it's awesome. I mean, I really hate this attitude that you get from a lot of people. And I know I don't want to go into a whole rant because that's Mad Dog does it better than me, but there's this huge kind of mantra, and I don't know what it is. There's this kind of attitude from a lot of people in the community that you know, it being on another platform other than your platform is a bad thing. You know, it's this, the whole exclusivity thing just seems just so crazy. It's like people getting ate up about the fact that it's on this platform and it's not on my platform, and it's like, oh, you know, it's ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous. I mean, look at how many platforms the original leak came out on. You know, it's, here we are 20, 30 years later, and we've got the same argument about whether or not the Spectrum or the Commodore 64 is better than this one. I don't care. It's great that everyone who has a platform they can play the game on can play the damn game. It's awesome. It's wonderful that there's more people that can play the game. That's all I care about. But there we go. Rant over. But no, it's just one of those things. I mean, you've probably seen this bubble that, you know, the community really, I'm not saying the elite community, but like gamers, as a general kind of thing, they kind of get et up about things like that, and I don't understand it. Why it's such a big deal? I mean, we're all gamers.
Yeah.
Why does it matter what side of the road we drive on, sort of thing? You know what I mean? It doesn't matter. Oh, there we go.
Yeah.
Game of the end. Do I know if the ambassadors for Gamescom have been named yet? I do not, but I know of a few favourites, so I can say no more. Millstone Barn, when is the Raspberry Pi version of Elite Dangerous coming out? I would love it on Raspberry Pi. That would be awesome. It'd be portable Elite Dangerous. That would be amazing. Take it anywhere and plug it into someone's TV. Crazy. Good question there from Neil M. How much of an improvement is the new controller profile? You struggled with the standard one. Massively. I must admit, I basically got first hands on with the new setup on the Friday when I was at Frontier. By the Monday, I was demoing in front of press. So if you can take that kind of pressure with it, then it must be a good setup. So yeah, I mean, it's really good the way they got it. So like the colored buttons on the front, you hold them down, you get a little pop up on the screen, and then the D-pad controls gives you multiple options. The shoulder pads give you different options. So every color is a shift into a different mode on the controller. Within about an hour, I kind of like, yeah, red, you know, B and down on D-pad, landing gear, you know, Y and up, that's jump to cruise, you know what I mean? It all just worked. It was really, really good. Simber 1540, I just noticed that comment there. Did I manage to get a world record in energy drinks consumed at E3? Damn, drink everybody! Do you like that? That's nice. Oh, interdiction. Well, it's just an eagle, I'll take him out. I cut down on my caffeine content considerably when I was at the game show, because I was already hopping and bouncing around. I've kind of acquired the new label as Tigger, because I was that bouncy and happy when I got there. But, are you an enemy? Is he in enemy territory? He's clean. Oh, no. Oh, that was close. I nearly shot on a clean federal vessel there that just wanted to scan me. Ooh, that could have been bad. That could have been bad.
That was very close.
What can we do? Keeks X1. Do I have an Xbox One yourself? I do now, yes. It's great because my 360 was on its last legs and it is an absolutely fantastic little entertainment device. So it's in the front room. It's got all the things on it, which is awesome. And I can play Elite on it in the front room, which is great. Shenre, yeah, you probably got a point there. People get passionate about things. And I think that's this is one of the things I was talking to the guys at Frontier, and there seems to be this general kind of misplaced passion in a lot of areas I've seen where people expect, they want things to be 100% perfect. And when it's not their 100% ideal vision of perfection, they get really worked up about it. And it's like, they kind of put that anger out at the thing that they love, you know what I mean? So it's this real kind of strange effect that you see happening. They love this thing so much that they've got to scream and shout about it because it's not 100% perfect. And I've seen that a lot in the forum posts and just generally, you know, it is such an odd thing. But such is the nature of people, I suppose. I'm just innocent and sheltered life, me. That's what it is. So, Bubble, you're not currently in the game at the moment, are you?
I'm not.
Oh, dear. And you said you've got about 5,000 light years to go?
5,000, yeah.
Oh, how long, roughly, has that taken you to get as far as you have?
I started going when PowerPlay released, because I wanted to do it in the Diamondback Explorer.
Yes, yeah.
So, I can't remember when that was.
Oh, crikey. Probably was a month ago now, roughly. I've lost track of time.
Yeah, it must be about a month.
Crikey, that was zipped by, hasn't it? Wow. that's crazy. So you've taken about 3-4 weeks, maybe. I mean, how long on average game time are you spending in a session, sort of thing?
I've probably only spending about 3 or 4 hours a day.
But that's still, that's pretty good going to get that far in that length of time, though. I'm just wondering whether you're going to get back in time. But, we'll see. in time. I'm not going to say anything more than that.
I feel like I'm being teased by saying in time.
Yeah, there's things going there. Now, David kind of hinted at some of the press interviews that there is more things to come. Obviously, the big announcement from the Xbox One, the big addition going into the Xbox One version of the game is obviously the CQC, which I can say without a shadow of a doubt is amazing, and I love it. It's right up my alley. Did you see much of that at all?
I did.
It's like Quake 3 in spaceships. So I'm in my smegging element, you know. I'm a big fan of like Quake 3. I used to get into tournaments and things like that. So really, really love that. And I know it's not going to be everyone's cup of tea. Now, don't think because I'm praising CQC and stuff that suddenly you have to ditch everything you're doing in the game and play PvP or else sort of thing. No, this is what I love about Elite is the variety. You can play it however you want. Like, for example, what you're doing now, Bubble, really peaceful, relaxing thing you can do, and you can see some wonderful things when you're out there exploring, and that is fantastic. I love it. I've been there, I've done that. But now the fact that we can actually jump into PvP at any time we want, when CQC is released, that is. Trespass warning, I'm not even close. Damn you. Sorry, go ahead, mate.
I agree. It's I've been going out exploring, and somewhere inside I've just been going, I just want to, even for just 5 minutes, to have a battle with someone, and CQC would let me do that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, I think I mentioned it, that, you know, it's a very conscious decision that they've gone with, where it's just a menu option you can pop up and you can go into like a simulation mode and play it. That's how they've done it, which I think is fantastic, because that would really help if people like it, particularly like in your situation. I mean, even, you know, myself, and I'm kind of going around, I'm in my one ship, which is spec'd for one thing. Sometimes I don't want to fly over and get my vulture and get into some combat or anything. I just want to dive into something like that. So it's going to be really, really great that we can just dive into some PvP and play it. And it's really, really good fun, I must admit. It's a complete different pace to the rest of the game. And hopefully it's going to direct some of that misplaced passion. I'm not going to call it anger anymore. I'm just going to call it misplaced passion from now on. Because I know a lot of people really want to play PvP in the main game, and they're kind of not sure where to direct that. So you get a lot of people which automatically get labelled griefers, which I think is unfair to jump to that conclusion that someone's a griefer because they want to play PvP. I think we all need to be fair and think about it. Yes, there are people out there that just, you know, don't know how to pirate very well, and they grief. But there's a lot of people out there who desperately want to play Elite and make it a living, breathing world, which, you know, feels like it's got some danger in it and stuff like that. And I appreciate that people want to do that. But at the same time, it's too easy to do it in a way which just comes across as bad behavior, basically, which is unfortunate. So it's going to be great that we can jump into CQC, we can just have that fun, instant action, blast it to some PvP, and jump straight back out again and carry on playing, which cannot wait for that. I spoke about it in depth on Lave Radio on Tuesday, but I take it you read up a bit about it, haven't you, Bubble?
I have.
Mm. Yep. Yeah, so the basic premise of it is you've got Team Deathmatch, Deathmatch, and capture the flag, obviously 6v6 or 12 players total. Things like power-ups, we spoke about this so much, it's almost on flash memory, I can just call it up. Good question there, sorry. Do you get a special PvP rank from Shenrei there? Yeah, there is a championship rank that you get, and people can see it in the main game, so if they see that you're a champion in one of the ranking systems there, then they know to maybe leave you alone and not get into PvP with you, which is quite cool. I like that. Hello Meow, did they just make an announcement for Gamescom? Maybe, but I'm worried I can't say anything about it, so I will go and check first to see if I can tell you the thing that you might already know. Another one, Millstone Barn, do we need a Microsoft Gold membership for Elite Multiplayer on the Xbox One? You need silver membership to be able to play solo. You need gold to be able to play with other players. And that's just the way that Microsoft servers work. That has nothing to do with Frontier kind of making that decision that, oh, you must give Microsoft money to do this. That is just the way that Microsoft works. Which, you know. SpyTech, yes, I want to clear up this confusion. Right, there was a couple of confusing comments in some of the press reviews and things like that were written up. It is CQC Championship. So it is Close Quarters Combat Championship. There's two C's on the end. so, yeah, these TLAs are really confusing, I know. But yeah, that's what it should be referred to. Caleb Dark, you can mention the other game by name. I'm not going to bite your head off if you say that. Do I think it's the equivalent of Arena Commander in Star Citizen? It's hard to say because I've played both, but it feels different. I mean, CQC is it does have that same kind of feel as it being an instant action respawning. You know, as soon as you blow up, you can jump back into another ship or pick a different loadout or something. It has that kind of instant gratification of that sort of gameplay, but it definitely feels different. There's no like waves of enemies or nothing. There's no kind of I don't know whether the NPCs are going to be in there or not yet, and I don't know if I can talk about that. It feels good. Like I said, it feels like a Quake match. You know, that's how it feels. So it feels different to the Star Citizen's Arena Commander mode, absolutely. And I think they've got more things planned for how Arena Commander's gonna play out, actually. So. Shenrei, not sure I follow that. Wonder how they will stop players kill trading in CQC. Oh, so you have people working for opposite sides killing each other equally to get scores ranked up on there. Unfortunately, when I saw the version of the game, it didn't have any of the ranking systems or leaderboards enabled yet, so I didn't see how they're doing that. Unfortunately.
That's a good question. Will you have a wing style system in CQC? Will you be able to talk to your teammates?
Effectively each team, the six players, it works like a wing, which is odd really, because I thought it would be four players, but I think six v six is a more comfortable fit for the size of the maps they're working for. But I'm pretty sure it supports all the things like, you know, the Xbox Live audio comms and stuff like that at the moment. So when it comes over to PC, I'm sure you'll be able to have voice comms with all the players simultaneously in there. It kind of makes sense. You need to coordinate it with the team. And I will say that the Frontier QA department, they are evil. They are so evil. They group up and they're like in a tight wing formation, like a flying V. And, you know, the guys were saying, it's like they've walked past the office a couple of times and you could hear the head of the QA department is like shouting orders at, like, go, 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 go for the flag, go for the flag, go, go. And they just coordinate so well, sort of thing. They absolutely wiped the floor with us when I played. I came about second or third, I think, something like that in the ranking. So it wasn't too bad, but they really did hammer us on the design team at the time. So yeah, they are mean.
Well, that's what you do when you try to fight the people who play it every day.
Yeah, they knew what they were doing. Ooh, this enemy is wanted. We'll see in a courier. Ooh, get it. Combat pew pews. Yeah, I've missed pew pews. Now, see, this was the thing when I was playing all the training missions at a certain gaming event. I was doing the same little bits over and over, so I, you know, even though I was playing Elite non-stop for 4 days, I wasn't really playing Elite, you know what I mean? I was just kind of doing the training missions over and over again. But that is one thing which has improved on the Xbox One version. Well, I don't know if you saw any of the videos of that bubble at all, on the Xbox version.
Of the training missions?
Yeah, the new training missions.
No, I haven't seen them.
So they've drastically tweaked them, and I think that change will come back to PC version as well. So to begin with, you've got gimbaled weapons, which makes the world of difference.
It does.
It's particularly on the training things, because you really want to be starting with a ship which is easy to get your head around how to use everything. So that makes an absolute massive difference. But also the ships that you get to use in each scenario kind of scale with the scenarios as well, so you're not stuck in a sidewinder for the entirety of that of the training set, which seemed a little mean when you look back at it in hindsight. But it's gonna be an absolute godsend for new players coming to the PC version to have those training missions balanced. So it was a lot easier to do the missions, I must admit. And it kind of, with the new controller as well, it was great. It kind of just slipped into that play, like I said, in about a day, and I was like, I was just zipping through. It was great. I'm just looking at some of the things on there. Will there be wings? I think we covered that. Sorry. Combat and stream chat does not play nice together. Oh, I missed. Curse you. How about you? Oh, that's a good one from Deus Ex there. Someone mentioned the QA was using classic MMO role properly, like tank. Is that how it works already? So yeah, so one of the things we were saying to the journalists at E3 was, oh damn it, drink! Stop shooting me whilst I drink! The funny thing that came up, because we've got the Eagle, the Sidewinder, and the Federal Fighter are flyable ships in CQC, and the Fighter is awesome, it's so much fun. The Sidewinder is like the biggest ship in that mode, so it is like a tank. It is really the tank class. It lets you take a lot of damage. You can kit it out with, enhanced capabilities in order to be more powerful for that respect. And then you set up the little ships you can set up the Eagles like DPS almost, which is such a weird thing to say, to talk about like in RPGs terms. But it is, you know, these ships do have these great kind of roles that they fit into. Like the Federal Fighter makes a great flank carrier. You know, because you can set it up, mm-hmm. You can put the countermeasures on it, you can put the full power to engines and just boost through, because basically it's got virtually no shields and hull on it at all anyway, so if you get hit, that's it, you're screwed. So you want to kind of be nippy and get out of the way. Next question, Dex, do you think Frontier will release the training missions as downloadable demo? I would like them to. But I don't think they've got the time to do that, really. It's one of those things, they are so hard-pressed. I mean, CQC, and this was really frustrating for the guys, I must admit, but CQC was so close to being playable for E3. They were pushing really hard to get it into a playable state because, you know, it would have been a great thing to show people there at Thing. Unfortunately, it was a couple of weeks away from being polished enough to show anyone. Like I said, I was really lucky to see it in the state that it was, because normally they wouldn't show anyone. It had debug menus and stuff on there and things that I shouldn't have seen, but you know, but this is part of development, this is what happens. But yeah, it was so close to being done, so unfortunately they are really hard pressed for time. They are working so hard.
Yeah, it's the last thing you want to do is show something unpolished at a big event like the Electronics Entertainment Expo.
does that count if you say it? Do I have to drink?
I don't know.
Simmer 1540, is Frontier worried that Interstellaria will have walking around in ships on planetary landings on release? I am Googling this now, my friend. I have not heard of this.
Never heard of that before.
It is... Oh, it's a Kickstarter. Okay. And... Oh, whoa! Is that like a 8-bit, 16... Oh, that looks awesome! Oh, that looks so cool. It's like a 16-bit side-on view kind of... Oh, space game. Oh, I love it. Love it. Do you know what? I think Frontier... Well, many of the Frontier staff would probably end up backing that if I tell them about it. That looks really cool. Thanks for sharing that. That's awesome. I think Atomica's cat is going all over the keyboard. Hi, Atomica. Is it me, or do you have your headphones on the wrong way? No, I don't think I've got the headphones on the wrong way. Spytech. Do I know anything about the F-63 Falcon, or is it a typo in the newsletter? Is that... Did they mean the F-63 Condor?
Because that... It says in the peak of the week, a render of the newly modelled F-63 Condor.
Yeah, so that's basically what we used to know it as.
Yeah.
They've basically just shortened it and said that, hey, it's the Federal Fighter. Everyone knows it is the Federal Fighter. So, yeah, I think that's just a typo. But, yeah, I do know about it. It's nippy. It's quick. It is amazing fun to play. And it is really good for getting through those tight corridors. Because one of the key things that they've done in CQC is all of the maps, they're like oversized outposts. You know, they're quite these big structures. And they've got these little corridors that you can zip through. And there's this real kind of emphasis on the gameplay to get you close to the edges of things and kind of go behind things and get out of sight, because they have a system of line of sight in there now. So if you lose line of sight, the lock starts to fade and you'll lose it. Oh, I can't fast. I've got 4 minutes between my next quota, so I'm going to stop for a second. So you kind of, it encourages you to get to this, stick close to the geometry and zip through the corridors and stuff like that. So even though the Condor is quite light and doesn't have a lot of hull available to it, if you play it right, you can still be deadly with it, which is awesome.
Yeah.
Wheatley T, have I tried the Xbox streaming on Windows 10 yet? No, I have not had a chance to try it, but I believe Shorty and Mrs. K are watching a Blu-ray on the Xbox One, so I can't do that right now. But I will try and set that up one night. That would be cool to do that. Any more questions on there? Yes, it counts as a drink. That's, whoa, there must be a delay on the chat there. There's quite a bit of a delay on there. Cool. Right, so we're gonna run through the newsletter. What have we missed on the newsletter so far? Oh, we've got my ugly face on the newsletter, which I won't share. yeah, I was kind of excited to be sat just off to the side of the GameSpot stand there, which was quite cool. Which is, I mean, it's funny. It's like you see things behind you. Obviously, you see the videos on these channels, and you know the years that I've watched things like the GameSpot show and stuff like that on when they do their E3 coverage. And stuff. Damn it! it's great to see the sets and everything like that. And then when you kind of look off to the side, it's like it's awesome. It's like seeing behind the scenes is just really good fun. So I was just pleased to be there. And they plonk me in front of the screen.
It's a bit like looking on a TV set. Everything looks like it's in a house, and then you look away and there's lights everywhere, and it's...
it is, it's surreal. It's just crazy. It's like half of a house. But yeah, the really fun thing about doing that, and I can admit this openly now, that there was no plan for what I was going to show. We literally just went in it and just played a live game, as it was. There was no kind of coordination and any kind of tactics and, oh, let's show this, and if the case has a glitch, we do that. It was completely live and unscripted. We just did it, which was awesome. You know, it was great that the game was working on Xbox so well that we just dived in and just played, which was amazing. You know, it's not many people will go around and take a risk like that. Like David said on the I think it was on the IGN stream, he's like, we're doing a live demo. What could possibly go wrong? I think I was good. I don't think I crashed into anything when I was doing those streams, so I'm okay. Ooh, that's an interesting one there. Oh, thank you there. XRG's put the picture of my ugly mug up on there. Yes, thank you. Ryan Extreme, greetings, Ambassador. Nice to see you again. You heard that Sarah mentioned that throttling back will have consequences. Any news on that? Throttling back in what respect? No, I haven't heard that, actually. Might not have anything to say on that. Oh, Atomica, that was your daughter. Hello! we did think it was a cat for a second there. But yeah. Oh, dear, dear. Next thing on there. Can I get my quota yet? Can I get my quota? Can I say I dropped my merits? Oh, 1 minute. Come on, 1 minute. Yeah, I was away for 2 weeks and my merits dropped, so I've gone back down a rank. Oh, sorry, Alyssa. Sorry, terrible. E-Device, do I think I'll see these types of stations in the main game? Sorry, Ben. No, I don't think we're going to see the CQC arenas in the main game. They were very adamant that there wouldn't be any kind of cross-pollination, specifically to prevent kind of nasty gameplay interactions that would ruin it for people. So I don't think we're going to see those stations. Well, I mean, if you're referring to whether we're going to see those kind of structures, not really. That they're not procedurally generated like the outposts are, because the outposts are kind of built up out of segments. These ones are kind of handcrafted out of the segments, so I don't think we're going to see those ones in there. Arathon, that's a good question. The Federal fighters are going to be back in the game, but can we upgrade them to have an FSD? No, I don't think there is anywhere near enough space inside them. There isn't even a cargo rack inside that. There is no space inside that Federal fighter. When you get up close and you have a look at these things, they are tiny. They are absolutely minuscule things. There is no space inside them whatsoever for anything other than a couple of guns. That's it.
Rumours are that Ceres has built a small volcano in the FDev car park and is heavily guarded by elite AIs as she pilots the demise.
Yes, evil. Oh dear, yes. I can neither confirm nor deny the presence of a volcano in the car park. All I can say is my car was fine when I got back. It was quite funny, actually. I parked near the hedge, and it was overgrown by the time I got back. So, good evening, JMC. Thank you for joining. Back with Arissa. Yes, I've not left Arissa. I've backed her for over like 3 weeks or something now. Toad, I think it is. So yes, I'm sticking with Arissa. I picked a winner. I think I went away to E3, and I come back, and I just said it again, didn't I? Damn it. I come back and obviously Arissa's in number one spot, so woohoo! Picked a winner. Oh, there we go. XRG's got the Twitter status there. Okay, so direct from SJ herself. The combat AI upgrade, elite dangerous players reversing at speed will soon get their backsides handed to them on a silver platter. I'm being evil. I did notice that the Xbox AI seemed to be a little bit more mean when I was doing that, and it didn't seem to work as well, so I'm kind of hoping that's going to cross over. That's going to be good. It's one of those things that it seems like a bit of an unfair tactic, I must admit, so I'm kind of glad that's being dealt with. Zoom, 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 zoom. Kaluhukan. There we go. Great fun. Yeah, I'm glad to see that they're dealing with that. Consequences will be dealt. We will all get our comeuppance for our evil reverse flying. Arathon, what you meant was talking about putting the Condor into bigger ships. Other than that Xbox One release trailer that we've all seen, where it looks like a Federal fighter launches out of the underbelly of an Anaconda, I know nothing more about that. And I was just met with smug grins whenever I asked. So I can say nothing more about that. But I would like to know as well, because as soon as I can afford to get something big like an Anaconda, then yes, I do want to have a look at chucking a Federal fighter in it. Because it's awesome to be able to mix and match your gameplay styles. It's great. Abacus, yeah, you're absolutely right. That was a blast when Toad hunted me down. I will never defect again, I don't think.
Well, you know, if you do, there'll be someone hunting you.
Yes, yeah, SJ is being really mean with her minions. As XLG is saying there, we'll have to see how that reverse flying is going to affect the FAR flying. I honestly don't know. On the subject of flight assist off, actually, I must give a huge shout out to the other ambassadors that arrived. Obviously, we had Anderson DeGreer, Shazbot, Fifth Horseman, and Resri came and helped out from the US side. Some dude called Crash that got dragged over from the UK. and we had legendary streamers Bad News Baron and I Am Spoon there at the event, which was awesome to meet up with these guys. They were absolute fantastic folks. It was really, really good to share the experience with them and just spread the good word of Elite. It was awesome. Huge props to Shazbot, actually. He was playing and his abilities with flight assist off were scary. He was zipping around these things, and I was like, "How the heck are you doing?" So I think some of the things he was showing me, I was like, "Dude, that is awesome." So I'm just gonna stay on his good side, you know. It's like, as long as he's in my wing, I don't care. Yeah. Oh yes, Max. So that was one of the other things. AI targeting subsystems does add some flavor to the fight. Absolutely. I do like the module damage makes fights more interesting, and you know, things that happen to it are really, really good fun, I must admit. Hype for a new module landing bay. Yeah, I'd like to see that. As soon as I know about it, I will be squeeing from the rooftops, I guarantee that. But no, unfortunately, I've not seen anything more on that. It's one of those things where it would be a really great feature, but it kind of, like everything else, it gets prioritized. You know what I mean? There's things in the game which make sense to release when they release it, and there's things which just get bumped off the list because it doesn't make sense to do them right now. You know, it wouldn't add enough to it. But.
Mm-hmm.
Commander Perrins! Greetings, Commander! Yes, I'm glad to be back. where did we get to? Where did we get to, Bubble? Yes, the Guinness Book of Records. This was a nice surprise. I literally disappeared onto the show floor to help at one of the events, come back up to the room, and David stood there with a certificate in his hands. So that was a really nice thing. I wasn't expecting that at all. So yeah, there was David won, or was it? I'm not sure if it was David or it was Elite in particular, won the longest running space simulation series award from Guinness World Records, which was pretty cool. I mean, 30 years is a long time.
It's a long time.
It is a long, long time. It's longer than a lot of us playing the game, I think. Mad Dog. Hey, Mad Dog's here. Greetings, Commander. Thank you for covering the stream. You and Toad did a wonderful job. Thank you. Other bits on there. Oh, here we go. So here's the announcement we were talking about. Thing. So we'll be in Cologne at Gamescom the end, beginning of August. They have network CQC playable. Yes, on the show floor. And a massive PC setup. 4K displays, VR headsets. Awesome, 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 awesome. Oh, that's great to hear. Yeah, I hadn't heard that myself. I've not heard any news about what the Gamescom arrangements are. So that is all news to me as well, which is great. Yay! Right, let's head over to Angel Station. No, Mad Dog. No, sorry, my friend. I didn't see you at the start. Don't know if the chat wasn't coming through. I would have noticed your name, surely.
Surely. It's pretty hard not to hear Dog.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you can't notice Dog, there's something wrong there. I'm not going to ask Bubble his age. Younger than me, I expect. Woof, woof. No, we didn't see you, Mad Dog. You're so unobtrusive. Cool. So, oh yeah, so I think we've covered some of the bits on CQC and things like that as well. Yeah, key point there, I mean, like it says, it goes beyond their original vision for Elite Dangerous. It's something new, something they felt like was an important addition they can add in. And I was talking to the designer, one of the designers of it, was Dan at Frontier, and it's something he really wanted to do. Interdiction. What is it? A courier? I think I can take a courier. I'll be alright. It's something that he really wanted to do, and he's really keen on the idea of it becoming like a proper eSport type event. And I mean, I am too. I mean, that would be absolutely awesome. I'd love to run some tournaments and things like that. I mean, definitely Bubble. We'd have to get into some death matches on that. That would be so much fun. cannot wait for that to be a thing. It wasn't obviously mentioned prior to any of this stuff we've seen. So it's nice now to see that they've got the opportunity to kind of stretch their wings a little bit and try something new. I mean, other than multiplayer, CQC is kind of the first real departure from the core of Elite. I mean, I don't know how familiar you are with the earlier games, Bubble Tour. Have you played any of the earlier ones at all?
Elite Dangerous from the first go.
But you know of the early game. I imagine you've read up a little bit on this stuff like that. So yeah, I mean, pretty much everything that's been in Elite Dangerous so far is faithful to the original. The only thing that everyone's obviously really keen to see is from Frontier Elite 2 on the Amiga and First Encounters, is obviously the planetary landing stuff. Everyone wants to see that. But other than multiplayer, CQC is... Oh! Nearly rammed me. Oh, I rammed him. That'll do. Didn't waste any ammo. whoopsie. Yeah, other than the multiplayer, the CQC is one of the first real major departures from the core gameplay elements of Elite. Which is great to see, I think. And a lot of people have turned around saying, oh, this isn't Elite, this isn't PowerPlay, isn't a core feature of Elite, and so on and so forth. It's nice to see that they're kind of broadening the horizons and trying to do more with the game. So I don't understand why people think that's a bad thing. I think it's great that they're attempting to do more and different things with the game rather than just a carbon copy of the original, because it can all coexist peacefully in one game, and it's really, really cool to see it. I just saw the comment from Abacus there. I'm about 13 when I play Elite. I feel about 13 whenever there's anything to do with Elite. It's like, yay! It's like, my game's back. And see, this is the thing that does make me laugh, though. I mean, a lot of us have waited literally decades for the sequel of the game. And then I find it really hilarious that people get frustrated having to wait a few months for an update or something like that. You know, the whole Xbox thing is like, they're getting CQC first, it's not fair, why aren't PC getting it, and blah 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 blah, and all this kind of stuff. And it was like, guys, it literally is gonna be a matter of months and you're gonna have it anyway. There really is nothing to complain about here. It's I don't get it. I don't get it. Again, misplaced passion. I'm not gonna call it anger anymore, it's just misplaced passion. But
yeah,
I don't know. Yeah. Sorry, Bubble, go ahead, man.
People are complaining, PC should get everything first, PC. But CQC really feels like it fits, like, the games that come to consoles, they're very first-person shooters, and it feels like it fits that more.
Yeah, I mean, one of the key things they wanted to do is they wanted to get the feedback of players who play a lot of competitive online shooters, and the biggest platform for that at the moment is the consoles, is the Xbox and the PS4. So it made absolute sense to say, hey, look, if you guys are making this, let's put it on this console platform, get the feedback of the players, are going to be the most harsh and critical of whatever things that go into that, so that we can improve it and tweak it. And then when it comes to PC, you know, it'll be polished with all of the improvements it needs, like leaderboards and all the other bits and pieces that might not be in there on the initial release. So it absolutely fits, and I don't understand why people think it's bad. You know, it literally is going to be a matter of months and we're going to be playing it anyway. And I guarantee that some of those people that are complaining about not getting it first will be the first people to complain about not liking it as soon as they get it. I guarantee you. Some people out there just want to complain. They don't have a valid argument. They just want to complain about things. So.
Yeah.
No point giving them the time of day, I don't think.
And indeed, as Mad Dog says, Xbox players are going to come with no preconceptions about whether it is Elite or not.
Yeah, exactly. They're not going to know whether or not it's part of the original game, or whether it's some new feature, whether they're just going to come in and go, oh, there's this cool mode, and they're going to play that a little bit, and they go, oh, what's this open thing? Holy shit, there's an entire galaxy in this thing, and it's going to be really good for the game, because it's going to encourage people to get into something they wouldn't normally do. I mean, I can say, you know, hands down, when I was a kid, I was a console player for a period of many years. You know, I had the Nintendos and the Segas and things like that. Didn't suddenly turn me into an idiot when I bought a console. It was just I was playing on a different platform, you know. And there are people out there playing on console that might want something bigger and more complicated and think, hey, this is the first game on console which is really, really full of features and not simplistic and dumbed down in any way. Because, like I said right at the start, it is the full, uncompromised version of the game. So it's great to see that console players have got that option now. They're not having a dumbed-down version because that's what people think they want and need.
Indeed.
I missed a few, sorry. Hello Meow, isn't it just an exclusivity deal? Yeah, it's a timed exclusive that Microsoft have kind of squeezed out of them, basically. That's the way it works. Arathon, yeah, you've got a good point there. It's not knowing what's coming was what upsets people, and they make assumptions on the beginnings. But yeah, that's exactly what I got in trouble for, because I squeed at the thought of what I was seeing, but it wasn't what people were imagining was coming. So as soon as it wasn't what they were thinking, everyone got really angry. And it's like, I know, I understand that. And Frontier, yes, they're used to being secret. They run a very tight ship. They don't let a lot of things come out. And you can understand why. It's a competitive market. The gaming industry is really challenging like that. You can't be giving out information left, right, and center, because it can be damaging to the company. So it makes absolute sense why they kept everything close to their chest.
Yeah.
But it is a tricky balance. Where do you draw that line where you go too far past that, keeping the interest by doing what I do all the time very well, is teasing and kind of like hinting at things and saying, well, there's some cool stuff coming, guys, which there really is, and I can't say. And, you know, where do you cross that line where it just becomes downright irritating? It is a tricky balance, and it's something that Frontier are just learning all the time.
Because I'm sure that if Frontier came out and said, this is what we're doing, this is our development plan, the same people who are saying, you don't tell us enough, are going to say, well, if they can't do something, you're the same people who are going to say, oh, why didn't you do this? You said you were going to do this, hashtag refund.
Yeah, and it's going to happen no matter what. I mean, there's always going to be a percentage of people who are not going to be happy with how they deal with it. That's a good, it's a good idea what Arathon's saying there. Could do with a restart of the dev diaries, doing, you know, little hints at some of the assets they're working on, like how they made the diamond back. Yeah, I would love to see things like that. Again, the biggest problem with this is a question of time and resource. It takes a lot of effort to put these kind of things together. And Frontier are being really quite, can't think of a good word for it, but they're being really careful with the money they've got, and they're putting it into the things that really, really matter. Karakino, you're thirsty. Okay, then. E3! Nice big swig there. There we go. We're all going to be falling off the spaceport by the end of the evening. But yeah, I mean, I would love to see things like that. I know that they've been gathering a lot of media and resources and things like that. They've got lots of pictures and things that they could use on dev diaries and things like that. It is a question of getting people together. Now, like I said right at the start, I'm not sure, did I mention this on air bubble, or were you just having a chat before we started? But the Ed Lewis is really keen on doing more streams and things for start, which is going to be great. I mean, he's wanted to do that since he's come in the door. He wants to get more streams out to us. He wants to do more interviews of the dev team. He wants to try and get, you know, more stuff out to us, be more transparent and everything like that. He really, really wants to get to that point. He has been basically doing the job of three people, and I cannot stress that enough. Whilst we were there at E3, whilst we were there, I mean, he was working like 18-hour days easily, and that's not including traveling to and from the hotel. He was working his backside off. And to be fair, everyone was. You know, all of the Frontier staff were working so, so hard. When I arrived there on the Friday, there were people that had finished work 5 a.m. in the morning and gone home. They work incredibly hard. They really, really do. And they are stretching everyone to deliver the stuff to us. So I'm glad to say that they are getting more people in. Obviously, we've got Zach has joined the team, Zach Antonici, head of community. So it's going to be great that Ed's going to have more people at hand to do those kind of things. They can spread the load a little bit more. And hopefully, we're going to start seeing more streams from Ed, which is going to be great. It's going to be really, really good.
Yeah.
So it's all just a question of trying to get it set up and prioritized. And, you know, because they don't want to go blowing the development budget on things like that when there's things they need to be working on, like planetary landings, you know.
Yeah.
Sorry, I promised I wouldn't scream, but awesome.
I know.
I can't help myself. I can't help myself. Yeah, XRG's hit a good point there. It's like they're going to get complaints if they work on stuff that people don't care about. Well, yeah. This is the problem. There's always something that some people don't care about them working on. There's lots of people that didn't care about PowerPlay, so they got lots of complaints about things. And there's like, why have you done PowerPlay? Why haven't you given me a Thargoid yet? Blah, 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 blah. It's like, and like I said, it's a question of prioritizing it and doing things that make sense at the time. Because there are things that are all being worked on independently at different times. And sometimes there's things like, you know, we've seen several times, for example, the Federal Corvette. It's still needs some more work, which is why we haven't seen it yet. It's not that they've decided to just drop it or push off the side. So because it's not quite ready and it's relying on something else being ready, we're not seeing it yet. That's what it you know, there's these things kind of feed into other things, and there's prioritizations and stuff like that. So you can't just say, it's like, oh, you told us about this 2 years ago, where is it? It's like, well, there's some more things might need to feed into it for it to be ready, mm-hmm. sort of thing. So
yeah.
I'm not sure if I've missed any things. I need to find some pirates. What have we got? An eagle. Mostly harmless. Now, let's see if we can get... I want my D scanner. I want my warrant scanner. Here, pirate. Where are you? That looks like a pirate name. Ah, that's... Damn it. Need a pirate. No. Damn, where's the... pirates when you need them. Sonya Fireclaw. And completely clean. Damn it! There's some awesome names. These people here, it's like they look like deadly pirates, but they're just your average Joe. Oh, wanted. Excellent. Probably not a pirate, though. Zizimo, you've been watching people stream on Xbox One. They've had tons of questions. Well, everyone's got to start everywhere. And, I mean, I must admit, I don't like kind of getting into the term newbie and stuff like that. I think it's a bit derogatory, but, you know, it's kind of unfair to poke fun at people who've not played the game before. At some point, none of us played the game before, so, you know.
Everyone's got to start from somewhere.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, it's... I mean, this stream has always been about helping people out and showing them those things. So, I mean, if I do catch any streams of people playing it on Xbox One, I would probably jump into the chat and start giving help and advice, because to me, that's what this stream has always been about, is helping people out.
Indeed.
Come on. The thing I love about the Asp is when it turns broadside, it's just one big target ready to hit. Not so good when you're on the receiving end, though, I suppose.
No, it's something I never got to, a combat asp. It's just, an asp seems more apt for exploring.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, yeah, it's obviously... And that's the great thing about some of the ships, is they have these key roles, but they can be adaptable for other things. That's the thing which is really fun with them, actually. Shenri, look for pirates in the unidentified signal sources. Yeah, you're right. I was just trying to... past 16 minutes of time waiting for my next merits. But hang on, there's no content in this game, there's nothing for me to do. Hashtag flounce, I must leave. Oh no, wait, there's loads for me to do, I just need to go find it.
Yeah.
I won't go there. Oh, might as well make this a bit more worthwhile. Let's get warrant scanner on him. Yeah, Zemo, yeah, that was something that I was really chuffed about Frontier saying, is the fact that the Xbox One and PC version share the same galaxy, so it is a single community. They were absolutely adamant that they wanted everyone who's playing on every platform to be able to affect the galaxy and get involved and kind of work as a community. Even if you can't physically bump into those players in the game, at least you can kind of, you know, get up on a forum and coordinate and chat to people outside the game and in that kind of thing. You know what I mean? Because with the cross-platform play stuff, which is coming with like Windows 10 and Xbox, it's nice to see that you could do things like you could use the Xbox Live comm sort of thing and chat to someone. So even if you had like you had one wing of people which are playing on Xbox, you can have another wing of people that are playing on PC and they're kind of working together to help a power out in a certain area or something like that. It's, you know, it's great that we can all collaborate even if we can't physically meet up in the same space. So.
It would be amazing that if people on Xbox and PC could fly together, but it's licensing and it'd be a lovely thing to have, but it's not very possible.
Yeah, it's not that Frontier don't want to do it. I mean, I spoke about it. It is something which is very difficult to do, and you know, I don't think Microsoft are particularly helpful or forthcoming in that kind of stuff because it usually ends up being. Oh, there's a pirate! Awesome, sweet. Get my interdictor out. It ends up being really, really difficult to get multiple platforms to talk together. Yeah. So Microsoft are not always helpful in that kind of thing because they want you to exclusively use their entire platform from end to end. And if you're using anything else, they don't necessarily want to play nice. So there's a lot of problems there. So, you know, things like when you look at it, Fable Legends was a great example of how it could work. You know, Xbox One and Windows 10, you have the cross-platform play on that. But when you look at it, it's released on two of Microsoft's platforms. So it's no wonder it works quite well.
It's especially difficult when the PC and Mac versions are already talking to each other.
Yeah, exactly. And of course, everything for the backbone for Elite runs on like the Amazon Web Services, which, as you can imagine, Microsoft are probably not going to be keen to play nice with that, to be honest. They're not going to be jumping at the chance to do that. I mean, they have got a lot better. In their defense, they have got better. They've kind of encouraged people to get into like the open source kind of stuff and everything like that. But they've got some room for improvement. Let's just put it that way.
Yeah.
Oh, Zizmo, you didn't mean newbies. You were talking about yourself as a newbie. Sorry, I apologize if I took that the wrong way. I've had a lot of comments recently which have upset me because, you know, people getting quite aggressive towards the console players and stuff like that, and I kind of take offense to it because, you know, when I think about it, I've played on a console, my son's played on a console, and this kind of throwing everyone in that bucket and calling console players idiots and things like that, I think it's just wrong. There's just no point to it. It is discrimination, and I just think there's just no need for it. It doesn't solve anything. The whole PC Master Race thing, yeah, it might be a funny meme, but it just causes pain and anguish that we don't need. So I get really uptight about it, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
XLG, will Elite support DX12 when Windows 10 is released? I don't know the details, but I mean, it is possible. The engine's running DX11 at the moment. And the speed at which these guys have been putting out different like modules, like Mac version, Xbox One version, just throwing them out on platforms left, right, and center, I imagine these guys could probably get it on the X10 very, very quickly, and it would be a good thing. It would give us all a bit of a performance boost, so I really hope so.
Yeah.
It'd be good. Well, have we got another one? We got another one which is trying to get away. He's a pirate! Woo! I love the fact that these people now appear in Super Crews instead of in Signal Sources. Indeed. I love it. It makes the game feel so much more alive. It's awesome. I apologize if I'm missing chat in the meantime because I'm having fun. I'm having too much fun. Damn it. This is the problem. Yeah. Frontier, you have made the game too much fun now. I can't interact with the chat. It's just wrong. Hashtag flames. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Would we?
Nope. Oh dear, dear, dear. Throttle down, you get damaged. I forgot, yes. I've been told before I keep the throttle too high when I'm interdicting. I should really. I'm sorry. I just. Too much fun. Too fun. Sorry, just trying to catch up on the questions. Pleepe, PC gaming would be long dead without consoles. I think it is I think it's more complicated than that. It seems to be a very symbiotic relationship. When you look at consoles over the generations and what they've come to now, they have slowly but surely ended up becoming mini PCs. And I see this whole kind of convergence of all of the platforms and stuff, because at the end of the day, we just want to play games. I don't care if, you know, I've got a monster PC in the streaming room here, I've got a slim console underneath my TV in the living room, or if I'm walking around on my mobile phone, I don't give a flying monkey's poop what the platform is that I'm playing on. I want to play the damn game, and I don't care. So, you know, I see us getting to this point where we're getting this real convergence of platforms, and I think Microsoft are doing a really good job of that with their platforms. Want to see more of that.
Especially when we're seeing things like the Steam Machine, which is a blurred line between PCs and consoles.
Yeah,
and
kind of that streaming, it's kind of half platform, half just device sort of thing, which is yeah, quite cool. I like that. I mean, and it's great that we have all these options. You know, there was a time in the past where we wouldn't have all of these alternatives. We'd have to have one or the other. So it's great that we can play on what we want to.
Indeed.
Let's see what we got here. I missed one on there. What have we got there? Another eagle? That's got to be another eagle. Pirate, please be a pirate. Woohoo! Oh, it's too far away from my interdictor. Got a couple of seconds. Oh, Smokey the Bear. Sorry, I missed your question on there, but I think you've been answered on there. No, detailed surface scanner is the best one you can get for getting scans on there. So,
yeah.
Ooh, I think that's one of the things. You got the discovery scanners allow you to discover things. Obviously, some are better than others. And the surface scanner basically gets you a bonus for having better detail about the thing you're scanning. And hopefully more soon.
You're just being teased.
I know. It's so cool. It's just... All I can see is I've seen some awesome shit. Takes a lot from you, Smith. T-Corkin, no, I think we touched on this earlier on. It's actually completely the opposite, and I've got this direct from the horse's mouth. The PC version will not be restricted by console potential, and in them actually side by side developing it is not going to be any kind of restriction. In fact, like I said right at the start, it has helped because all of the optimizations they had to get in to get the game working on Xbox One are going to come back to PC, and we're just going to get a better experience overall, which is absolutely awesome. So we're not going to have any restrictions or anything in that respect. It's not something Frontier wants to do. They are absolutely adamant. The word which is ingrained in my head, because we said it every 5 minutes for every press interview during E3, was uncompromised. And I just said it again, didn't I? So, cheers!
Yeah, it's...
So I think we've covered the questions for now. I think we've covered most of the things, and I think so we can chill for a little bit now. I must say, it's very warming, the streaming room tonight, because summer. Oh.
Yeah, because summer.
Yes. Sweaty crash because summer.
The optimizations you have to do to release a game on console will help PC to no end. It just makes the game run that little bit smoother.
Yeah, and there is other things going on as well. I mean, I was talking to Frontier. One of the interesting things I was talking to them about, they had one situation which only happened on a particular combination of hardware for one particular person, and his machine was really high spec'd. But there was this weird kind of thing where one of the multi-threaded tasks would kind of get stuck, and it would complete before the calling action expected it to complete, and ended up causing a bit of a stutter. It was one of the stuttering things that we've seen, and it was because the machine was too good for what the engine required, sort of thing, which was really, really odd. So they are working on these things. Like I said, there still are like 100 or more people working on Elite for PC. the guys that worked on CQC were a different group of guys. You know, they went off and they worked on that as a separate project. The guys working on Xbox One were the team which had the most familiarity with the hardware and optimizing it, so they worked on that. And you know, it's one of those things that I've seen a lot of people saying about Frontier. Oh, especially when they announced Planet Coaster, they were like, oh yeah. My god, you know, so how can they work on another game? You know, it's going to take development away from Elite. And it's like, no. It's like they were already working on Planet Coaster. So think about this for a second, right? They were working on the PC version, the Mac version, and the Xbox version, and there was a whole other department that were working on Planet Coaster at that same time. And that has not harmed them getting PowerPlay out the door, has it? Mm-hmm. So, you know, the company is perfectly capable of dividing into large teams and working on multiple projects. And in fact, they've been doing it for years anyway. And throughout the whole development of Elite Dangerous, they were, you know, they outsource small projects from other companies. Yeah. You know, other companies just need 100 hours of an artist's time to work on something. They'll give up one of their artists and outsource them to that project and stuff like that. That's the way it works. And it's an intelligent business model to do. You don't put all your eggs in one basket, say we're working on Elite, or solely working on Elite and nothing more, blah, blah, blah. You spread your, your resources around. So it's, makes sense.
It does.
Good question, Arms Like Noodles, and I'm afraid I don't have an answer to that. The Xbox controller for Steel Battalion, do you think it would work on Xbox One and Elite? I don't know, but it is pretty awesome. That's the one with the dual sticks, if I remember. That thing is insane. But that would be really cool. There's always a point of contention with consoles, I think, isn't it? Is the controller support is one of those things where it needs support from the platform vendor, the controller vendor, and the people writing the software. Because typically there's no driver layer, so the games need some driver layer built into them. It's a real shame that more consoles don't allow that sort of thing. I would love Microsoft to turn around and say, hey, we support the X52s. Get in! There you go. That would be an absolute godsend for all of the Xbox players playing Elite, I think. It would be awesome.
Indeed.
Mikael M, obviously, nice to see you there. You've been on the inside and you saw some juicy secret details. Yes, I can't wait for Gamescom, and I did see some juicy details, and it's awesome. OMG, it's so awesome, and I can't talk about it, but it's great. It's great. All I can say is a lot of people's stupid fears about things not happening in the game will be dispelled very soon, TM.
You're teasing us too much.
Like I said, it's frustrating for me because I really just want to scream it out, and it's awesome. Like I said about the whole surface vehicles thing, I was absolutely adamant that it wasn't public information, that David had never even mentioned the idea of surface vehicles. But I think it just came up in this PC Gamer interview, and it was such an obvious thing that they said, oh, have you considered that? And David said, oh yeah, we've considered surface vehicles and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, I didn't even realise he'd mentioned it. So I'm here thinking, I can't tell these guys about anything like that. And then suddenly it's public knowledge anyway. I'm like, oh, really? Is it? Okay. Oh. Right. Damn.
Yeah. Surface vehicles would be something that seems so cool to have. Oh.
I don't mean to, but there you go. Okay. English Knight, yes! I've been through the... Yes, I had fun at E3, so everybody drink! It's good. T-Core, can some people have speculated that we might see some bits of Planet Coaster in Planetary Lands? I doubt that very much, my friend. That would be incredibly fun, but I'm afraid I don't think we'll see that. There might be some nice little tie-in Easter eggs, which would be fun to see, but no, I don't think we're gonna get that level of crossover. I would love all of my games to be in the same universe, and there would be like a Fallout planet, and there would be a Quake 2 planet, and all the games I want to play would just be a different planet. That would be amazing, but sadly, I don't think that's to be.
Yeah, that would be interesting. GTA 5 style racing in a week.
You just come and slam your sidewinder in the middle of the city and get out and start shooting people. That'd be brilliant.
Especially if you go into the modes that have rockets.
yes. That would be cool. Yeah. There we go. I got my merits again. Oops. Oh, collect. go, and I can head back to the other system now.
Someone mentioned having Planet Coaster in Elite, having a roller coaster going around the inside of a docking ring.
Well, I mean, that would be flat, wouldn't it, really? Because the gravity is so it would be very, yeah. That would just be a very boring ride, wouldn't it? I need to find where I was. Come on. There we go. Oh dear. Yeah. So I don't see that. Launch via roller coaster. Yeah. Did I see anything cool at E3? Drink again, Arathon, yeah. I was about 20 yards away from the Oculus consumer kit, and I didn't get a chance to go in there or see anyone. The closest thing I got to was walking past Palmer Luckey as we went to the restaurant. That was the closest thing to Oculus I got the entire time I was there, which arguably is pretty cool, but I didn't get to see the consumer kit. But by all accounts, it was awesome. Any guess on the No Man's Sky release? Christmas 2015. I've heard that rumours that it may get even pushed back further than that, I'm afraid, which would be a real shame if it is, but I really want to see it soon, though. I'm an idiot.
What have you done?
I've picked up corruption reports when I should have been getting garrison supplies. Okay, no problem. There's no point wasting them or throwing them away. I can take them somewhere useful. We can do that. Eowyn, yes, by all means, you can ask that. What's my opinion on solo mode and why? Do I think it was good, bad, misimplemented, or what? I know there's a lot of discussion between the whole open and solo. I'm currently playing solo because I thought I had a glitch with the network earlier on, and it wasn't Twitter or anything, it was just the web page. I could go back into open. I've got no issue playing it. In fact, I'm going to go back to open now just to prove a point. I really have got no issue with open play. I know early on I saw the frustrations that other people see in, but now when I think about it, and I've had a lot of time to think about it, I think having the option to do it is ultimately the best thing Frontier could have done, because there are people that want to play different ways. You cannot avoid that. And it's unfair to force people to play a certain way. And I know the mode switching is a contentious issue as well. But we can get onto that in a minute. But I like the fact that I can switch. I think it's the right thing to do, because I don't always want to play the same way. And I know a lot of other people don't always want to play the same way. But open play does have an important place. And I think indeed. I'm just gonna look at the chat for a second, because I'm gonna get distracted. But I've been playing open play a lot more recently, because I've realised that getting angry and frustrated with people you bump into out there is just a pointless thing to do. It is kind of like playing in a competitive online shooter. You've got to take that the falls with the highs sort of thing. You know what I mean? And when you actually survive an interaction with another PvP commander out there and stuff, it is really exciting, it is really thrilling, and it's I can see why Frontier wanted to allow that kind of gameplay experience to happen, for everyone to have that wild, dangerous experience. You don't know what's going to happen. Now, I know there's a lot of cover people saying things like, you know, griefers are a problem in there, and I can understand that. I had a moment at the beginning where I was like, it really, really annoyed me, where I wasn't wanting to go into PvP, and I was just wandering around in open. And when I think back to it now, I realise absolutely that was my own fault. It's like, if I didn't want that interaction, I shouldn't have been there. I shouldn't have been in open play. I shouldn't have been not expecting to get attacked by someone. And I think the only thing that Frontier have done wrong with it is they should really call open play roleplay. Because as soon as people see that, and accept the fact that, you know, you're going to be putting yourself into this dangerous PvP sort of situation, it suddenly becomes a lot easier to understand the fact that it's not the people out there that's wrong, it's just how you're thinking about playing the game is wrong, you know what I mean? And it's really hard to explain, and I think that's why there's a lot of discussion on it still. in the form, and why a lot of people are torn with it, and it is right that people get angry about it being one way or another, because it needs to be right, it needs to work right, it does still need some balance. I'm hoping CQC helps to bring some balance to that, because obviously some people want to jump into PvP, other people don't want to jump into PvP. Having the option to be able to do that as and when you please, I think is really going to help some of that, you know, people that just want to have that experience and not worry about the backlash from the community and stuff like that. Yeah, so I'm trying to catch up on the chat now. It is a really contentious issue. I don't think there's going to be a quick answer to it, and this is the problem. If there was a quick answer, Frontier would have implemented it already, and no one would be complaining about it. But that's the problem. I think it's a really, really tricky thing to get right. I want the freedom of open play, but if you don't want the risk that comes along with that, I think the only thing you do is I'm sorry, you have to play open. You have to play solo, sorry, and, you know, accept the fact that you're not going to be able to interact with other players, or play private group, you know.
Yeah, there are a load and loads of private groups, and if you want a private group, having people around but not PvPing, there are loads you can go into. And my stance on the whole solo open thing is I like going solo at some points, because I can, for instance, when I'm going to Sagittarius Ace, I don't want to have to spend the extra, even if it's a small bit of time, syncing up all the servers. I can just go in solo and deal with it there, and it stopped. I think there was someone coming at Sagittarius A killing people. I don't want to have to be killed when I get there.
That would be such a frustrating experience, wouldn't it? Yeah.
I would like to keep my exploration data, please. So I just hop in solo to do that.
Yeah. It's this is the thing. I mean, I know there's people that play open, they want to roleplay as pirates, and I've seen them arguing and complaining that no one should be able to switch to solo because traders don't want to be in open. So I'm sorry, no human wants to be on the receiving end of a negative gameplay experience.
Mm-hmm.
No one really does. I mean, some people will roleplay and roleplay that very well, and they will accept those kind of consequences, but not a lot of people want to have a negative gameplay experience. Everyone wants to sit down in front of the game and have a good session doing what they enjoy. And the problem is, you're not going to find a lot of players that want to be killed by you. So it's a bit of an unreasonable expectation to expect people to be forced to play the way that you want to play so that you have your experience. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that's, I think that's where a lot of the problems come in, when people are kind of expecting players to be there as targets for them. That's not really a fun experience for someone at the other end if they don't want to be doing that. If someone wants to be a trader all the time, they're going to be the target all the time, and that's not a fun experience for people, which is a big problem, really. It's a really hard thing to fix. How do you do that? I mean, the crime system at the moment still feels like it's not fighting those problems well enough at the moment. There's still balance that could go on there. You know, people saying about how quickly you can switch from one mode to another is a problem, because people can drop in and out different modes and run away and hide and basically. But then the question is like, what if that player doesn't want to be involved in that thing? You know, it's a difficult problem, and I don't see a good solution to it, which is going to keep everyone happy. I'm just hoping that as the game expands and features like CQC come in, there's gonna be an area where everyone can go to explore. You know,
but you're never going to make everyone happy. Never. It's just impossible. You can make the majority of people happy, but you can't make everyone happy.
Yeah, exactly. And this is the problem that Frontier we're always going to face with making Elite, because Elite is the kind of game where it's a huge amount of variation, and it's trying to do a lot of things for a lot of different people. So you're always going to run into that brick wall at some point where it's going to upset some people. You know?
Yeah.
If you try and please everyone, you're going to upset someone. Yeah, Mad Dog's got a good point there. Is like, being pirated is the only real risk of being a trader in open. That's right. And the problem is that as much as I would like to see, you know, everyone playing and enjoying the same experience, that traders in open are just not going to have a fun time. Some people will enjoy that. Some people enjoy the thrill of being chased and managing to get away. But a lot of people that are trading are just not going to want to enjoy that. And what they should be doing is they should be going into solo play. You know, what I think is wrong is when people trade in open, complain that they get interdicted and attacked. And it's like, well, I'm sorry, that's the risk that you've accepted when you've gone into open play. If you want to be a trader and you don't want to get beat up by players, go to a private group, go to solo. That's, you should be doing that.
It's all about choice, and there are some people who go on pirating who'd love everybody to be in opens because then they'd have loads of people to pirate, but some people just don't want to have that gameplay experience and choose not to have it.
Yeah, exactly, and it's really difficult. It is really difficult.
It's a difficult issue.
Ooh, crime sweep!
Because I'm sure that if they removed solo play, you'd have thousands upon thousands of people complaining about it, but it's just a difficult thing to do.
Yeah.
It's difficult to balance.
Yeah. It's tricky. I am not nearly clever enough to figure out how they're going to do that.
Yeah. Forcing people to play with open would make people leave the game, and some people wouldn't buy it because they know that they have to be online.
It would make it really, really painful for a lot of new players starting off. I think now I've got to the point in the game where I've got enough resources that it doesn't matter if I lose a few ships. It definitely is. I find open a lot more a fun experience. It is exciting, and you never know what's going to happen. It is really, really cool. I must admit that. And I was wrong to make the same mistakes that everyone else did, you know. And you know, this is the problem. It's like people make mistakes. People assume the game works in a certain way, and then get angry because it doesn't, and things like that. We've all done it, and I admit that openly now that I should have given open more of a broad chance of what it was trying to do, and I understand that now. So, Dagoro, greetings, Commander. You got a good point. The hard part is those who just beat up on the open traders and not pirate them. No demand in a cargo, etc. That is exactly the experience I had, which annoyed me and put me off open very early on in the game. Was that I would accept the fact if there was someone role playing as a pirate, I would probably open comms channel to them and role play along with them and haggle over how much cargo to drop. I think that would be great. That would be a fantastic experience. The problem is, people don't play like that. It's guns first, you know. People come blazing in and just blow people up, and at the moment the game just doesn't have the sort of mechanics for dealing with those situations. It doesn't have some of the, and I honestly, I don't know what would make it better. I don't know what would help that situation, but maybe harsher crime penalties, which I know Frontier have been trying. Maybe one of the things that we asked for early on was the ability to have a declare piracy option in the comms menu, for example, which was, you know, something which I would love to see in there, because it's a quick way of passing your intention on to your target, sort of thing. I think that would make piracy PvP interactions a lot more meaningful. But I don't think any of these solutions are really going to solve the underlying problem, that it's too easy for players to just turn around and be jerks. You know what I mean?
Yeah. It is.
Ooh, let's see. Concentration phase. I was trying to read the chat and land at the same time. Yeah.
It's never a good thing to try and mix. Is it like texting while driving?
Yes, you shouldn't do it. It's illegal, you shouldn't do it.
Mm-hmm.
Mad Dog, yeah, you got a good point there. Having different commander slots for different modes was something that we all asked for. We wanted multiple commander slots so we could play different ways. That might be a solution as well, so you have a solo commander. You know, so. But then the problem is with that, most people who would play open commanders would probably still not be playing traders, because they know they would be a sitting duck. So you'd have one commander that you'd be doing nothing but combat with, you'd have another commander you'd be doing trade or exploration, whatever you want to do in solo, in your nice quiet little sandbox environment. So it would just segregate two save games, effectively. it's you can see why Frontier allows the mode switching in that sense, yeah. Because you don't want someone to be playing hundreds and hundreds of hours to get high on combat, and then they have to play hundreds and hundreds of hours to get on trading and exploration, but they could never combine the two stats together. It would be really annoying.
Yeah. It's... And I think that maybe what CQC is kind of pointing towards, because it's separated away from PvP.
What have I done wrong here? I've done something wrong. What have I done? I've got corruption reports, and I've brought them to the wrong place. I've been paying no attention to playing the game. I've been so busy talking tonight, I've not really been paying any attention. Have I brought them to completely the wrong place? Feel free to shout at me in the chat if I have done it wrong, because I think I have.
It's just...
It's a Friday night. It's hot. I'm not concentrating. Zizmo, yeah, that's a good thing I've seen in one of the updates. Undermining creates bounties on your head now. You do need those incentives. That's an important thing.
Doug says pirates would have a better time financially if the NPCs were carrying higher value cargo on logical trade routes, and it would give them less incentive to attack players.
Sorry, I missed that. Was that from Dog?
Yeah. Pirates have a better time.
And that's the thing. I mean, really, if you're playing piracy, your target should be NPCs. That's what they're there for. You know, they're... We all know what NPCs are there for, don't we, Dog? I mean that's kind of the intention. That's what Frontier want to do. But yeah, I agree with you there. Is the NPCs are not really that juicy in a lot of respects. It's really hard to find a good target. But then it's that question of balance, isn't it? You know, yeah. I did see that change early on. We suddenly went to you found a lot more NPCs going around with no shields in type sixes and things like that, which were worth hunting down and scanning. But it's a tricky balance trying to make it worthwhile. I mean, piracy, very rightly so, is the way they've defined it, should be something that you do if you're really, really desperate. You know what I mean? It shouldn't be something you do just to make loads and loads of money, because there are much better ways of doing it in the game.
Yeah.
This is most trying to get me to defect. Oh, I'm not going to defect. If I defect, Fiery Toad will kill me.
Yeah. You know that he's just waiting. If you hit defect, he'll be right behind you.
Boom. Yeah. Right. I need to go to preparation targets. You're absolutely right. Where is the nearest one, and where am I? Oh god, I'm not going to the number one slot, that's miles away. I thought these were the targets. No, these are... God's sake. I swear I've just picked a target. Sorry, because of the delay in the chat, I'm not sure if I picked up the right one. Oh, no. Systems available for preparation and expansion. Yeah. You're right, I need to pick one of these ones which has a number on it instead. Where is the closest one? 4. Just don't want to throw these merits away, it seems like a waste. Let me try and get over there. Preparing, yep, there we go. That'll do. Where are we at the moment? There we go. I wasn't paying any attention. What did I miss?
Yeah, Shinerai kind of makes the point that the 20 cargo at a time hurts piracy, but it also hurts the griefers, people who just stick loads of cargo outside the front of a station to make a game an unenjoyable experience.
And this is the problem with with any kind of game design, really, when you're working on these things, is having to make compromises for things that are not popular compromises, mm-hmm. but you have to do them for various reasons. It gets really frustrating. I mean, what might be a nice thing that could happen is if that hard limit of 20 was limited to perhaps only near stations, for example, so that if you're in a pretty abandoned, you've just interdicted a trader and you're in your own little area of space, for example, it's just you and it's that trader, it doesn't really make sense to have that hard limit of 20 canisters. So maybe that's something that could be changed.
Yeah, it would become a sensible idea. I mean, if you're near a station, you could say that maybe the station is shooting the canisters because you're trying to... But if you're in open space, I don't see it as griefing.
Petrus has just said, actually, Michael B's confirmed that they want to do that, actually. But again, that's exactly what I mean, is even if it is the best idea, and we're all saying that's what they should do, it's an item on a big priority list somewhere. And I can say without a shadow of the doubt, if there's something that we don't like about the game, there is probably at least one person in Frontier that doesn't like it about the game and wants to spend some time on it, but they've got this huge list of priorities they need to finish first. And they keep looking at that list and thinking, God, I want to raise that cargo cap at some point. Yeah. But it's tricky. It's trying to find the best way of dealing with it, trying to prioritize it. We will get all these things, but it's just being patient. I think that is the key point of everything I've said tonight, is just patience. You know, we've waited 2 decades for this sequel. I think it's acceptable to give Frontier a couple of months just to finish the things they're working on. just let them do it.
Just don't be thankful you're waiting for decades between updates.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, we'll release Planetary Landings just in about 40 years' time.
Oh, don't even go there. Don't even go there. But, I think we just... Patience is a virtue. My 5-year-old says that. So if he understands it, I think we're all old enough and ugly enough to realise that... Cronus is shouting me in the in-game chat that we want all the things now! we are all old enough and ugly enough to know that we should be patient.
Patience. It's... No, if you locked an infinite number of developers in an infinite amount of time, you'd get everything you'd ever wanted, but...
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, like monkeys on typewriters.
Yeah.
Extra Station. Is that really the name of this place?
Extra Station.
Extra Station. They built one and then they built another.
I thought it sounded more like a Tesco's Extra.
Oh, that's what it is. Yeah, Tesco's Extra. Oh, they got fuel and everything out there. So that's good. Crashes. Zoom. Patience TM. Yes, that should be the new meme. I'm going to get Michael Brooks a t-shirt with patience. Patience.
Yeah.
When are we going to see Planetary Landings? Patience, Commanders. Patience. Yeah.
It's always a guess on how long Michael Brooks soon is going to be. It's coming soon, we promise.
Absolutely, it is all coming, it is all coming. BBC Micro, greetings, Commanders. Thank you for joining in. We were just talking about a lot of these things. I don't know how much of it you missed, but I did say right at the start that I don't appreciate the kind of the thought that, hey, it's being dumbed down or anything. It's not being dumbed down. It absolutely is not. It's a wild assumption that a lot of people are doing. They're assuming because it's a console, it's dumbing down, and I think that's just a really naive way of looking at it. It's absolutely not.
Potential Michael trolling. Planetary Landing is unlocked when the Milky Way details have been added to the stellar cartographic by players.
Yeah. Right, let's all take a corner of the galaxy and get scanning. quick. typical Michael.
You can land on planets as soon as you know where every single one of them is.
But that's what's going to be awesome about it, though, isn't it, really? Is you know, the planetary landing stuff, once you can do all that stuff, it's going to be huge. It's gonna, the game is going to be so much bigger. It's going to be insane. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think I've heard comparisons before, like the rings on a station are the same size as a map for GTA 5. And like, that's enormous.
You can't imagine it, can you? And when you look at things, I mean, go. I would suggest anyone, go if you haven't already seen it, go and have a look at Zoo Tycoon, because I've been playing it on the Xbox One with my boys, and they did some of the graphic stuff in there is amazing. Just silly little things, looking at like the smooth walkways and the ways that they're, because they're all procedurally generated and stuff, and they've got, you know, nice little brick walls that built up, stuff like that. I'm just looking at that stuff and I'm thinking, damn, that's going to look awesome when there's a sprawling cityscape in front of you. You know, it's like,